south side, can't get enough, can't get enough. East side, west side, worldwide. Ride out. Nah, I ain't got no kids yet, but this right here's for practice. I hate to get the seats in the bins, but that's how good your ass is. Make an old man get his glasses, make Wesley pay his taxes. Then follow your moves all week on Twitter, probably make a reconsider. You're now rocking with the best, man. Dress game down to the sex game. Won't rap, but the boy been blessed, man. Let you play with old vets came. She calling, she texting, she's falling. But let me explain. Gotta tell your old boyfriend skate, girl, cause don't play them.
Hello, my name is Manuela Pedraza, and I will be talking about Richard Delgado's A Plea for Narrative, and it is by Richard Delgado. And my part in this article is why out-groups should tell their stories. First of all, I would like to describe what an out-group is. An out-group is a subordinate group. It's more of a marginal group. It's the one who is not the dominant group. Now, the dominant group is the in-group, the one who has power. Therefore, they are the ones who, their positions stand as reality. Like, their situations or their, whatever it is that they go through is in favor to them. Now, that's the dominant group. The out-groups are the marginal subordinate groups, the ones with less power. This relates to the ethnic studies because I felt that the in-groups were the academic senators and the out-groups were us, the students who were trying to fight for ethnic studies. The academic senators, of course, had the dominant narrative because they had reasoning and like everything to do in their favor, which made us less of a... which made it harder for us. The narrative of the students was that it was important and it is seen as important enough or a requirement and a mandatory class to take.
Hi, my name is Byron Fuentes, and I'll be talking about Richard Delgado's article, The Plea for Narrative, and my part is El Hamar X Assembly for in the school. So it's basically talking about like how he's gonna assemble and have John Henry and talk for him because he believed it was white supremacist. And what El Hamar did was he gathered up a meeting in the middle of the school, gathered many students, a couple of faculty members showed up, a dean showed up, and he actually wanted to get the word out so people can hear what he had to say and what wasn't right about what they did to John Henry. El Hamar said that in the assembly that it wasn't right about what they did to John Henry because in the faculty they were all white, so they wanted to have someone of color, but in regards they just were trying to hire someone, but at the end they didn't. In Richard Delgado's article, El Hamar was being outraged, and that's how we felt in our school. Us as students, we felt outraged. So what I did, I participated in the blockade, and how dare they not want us to speak in the assembly because, well, I mean, this is our school, so we need to have a right for it. We pay the tuition for us to have a right here. So that's what they should let us do. And I'm not like for other senators to have a word for us. How can that be? Like, it's just unfair and white supremacist. We chose to operate independently from the institution. Okay, thank you very much.
Hi, my name's Jackie Marquez, and I'm gonna be talking about the Richard Delgado Plea for Narrative. Specifically my part, which is the judge's dismissal. It deals with how the dominant narrative deals with the institutions and them being in power. So how does this relate to the ethnic studies and the proposal we're hearing now here in school? It deals with how the academic senate is superior to the students here in our school, that they feel that they have the power to not let anyone talk, to speak out. They are based on social and on institutions. The narrative of the students was being marginalized. There are out groups, meaning that they are suppressed. They didn't speak out. They weren't able to speak out and talk about what they thought about the proposal in the meeting. Well, like the judge's dismissal, the judge did not want to, said that it was no point for this to happen, that it shouldn't have been brought to the court because it is no value. Like, he was not being racialized. That's what the judge says, that the whites are in power, that they could deal with whoever they want, if they want to hire him or not. That's what the judge dismissal was based on, that if that the whites have the power, that they could hire anyone they want. And that's how the ethnic studies is, that being dismissive, meaning that they are not letting them speak out for what they want, and that they're based on institutions. Thank you.
Hello, my name is George Quesada, and I'll be speaking to you about the Richard Delgado article, A Plea for Narrative. Specifically, I'll be talking about the anonymous letter that was written by either a student or a college professor. In this anonymous letter, the person spoke about the fallacies of the institution that don't allow for minority professors to be part of the process. In essence, it excluded, the process excluded minority professors. And he talked about the travesty through which the process eliminated John Henry as an applicant. It also followed the Al-Hamar X assembly on the university campus. It was particularly important because it followed a lot of the controversy that happened before the anonymous letter was written. Specifically, it was in response to the judge's dismissal. It was in response to Al-Hamar X's assembly, and it was particularly effective. Number one, it was anonymous, and two, it didn't identify anyone in particular. It identified a mindset of they were racist, and that it was possibly a white supremacist institution. For that, it was effective. Also, the anonymous letter talked about being eliminated through a process, or at least John Henry being eliminated through a process, possibly a process with racial overtones. So were we here as Cal State LA students when we weren't allowed to speak, and that's why it was necessary to do a blockade of the Faculty Senate. I think that the institution didn't allow us to speak, although they had the power to allow us to speak. How does this relate to the ethnic studies debate at Cal State LA? First, I believe that there were a lot of faculty senators who were outraged, but they didn't have the venue through which to voice their opinion, like the anonymous letter. Through the anonymous letter, they were the person was able to view their concerns. And I don't think that there were a lot of academic senators that were able to voice their concerns.
Cold world. Southside. Can't get enough. Can't get enough. Eastside. Westside. Worldwide. Ride out. Nah, I ain't got no kids yet, but this right here's for practice. I hate to get the seats in the bins, but that's how good your ass is. Make an old man get his glasses, make Wesley pay his taxes, then follow your moves all week on Twitter. Probably make a reconsider. You're now rocking with the best, man. Dress game down to the sex game. Won't rap, but the boy been blessed, man. Let you play with old vets came. She calling, she texting, she's falling. But let me explain. Gotta tell your old boyfriend.